incorporates many different types of diseases. So it's an umbrella term, and there's many, many types. But if whatever you have, if you have dementia, you're going to have a change in thinking, you're going to have memory problems, behavioral issues, and functional changes. Basically, it affects everything about who we are because it's a brain disease. And in order to be classified as dementia, those deficits in those areas need to be severe enough to interfere with daily functioning. A few years ago, dementia was really relabeled to major neurocognitive disorder, but in practice, almost everybody still uses the term dementia. But if you ever see major neurocognitive disorder, same thing as dementia. So there's, like I said, quite a few different types of dementia. Alzheimer's disease is the most common of all the dementias. Probably somewhere between 70% and 80% of dementia has an Alzheimer's component. Many times there's mixed dementia, as you can see in a pathway down the slide. Mixed dementia is when there's a combination of, say, Alzheimer's disease and vascular dementia, or vascular dementia and alcohol dementia. So it's just that it's mixed. Vascular dementia, sometimes called multi-infarct dementia, it is associated with having little mini strokes. And the symptoms you're going to see in vascular dementia will depend on the part of the brain that is affected by the stroke. Lewy body disease, I don't know if you're familiar with that, but Lewy body disease is basically kind of like the combination of Alzheimer's disease and Parkinson's disease. And it's important to know that a person has Lewy body disease because there's some symptoms that are more common in Lewy body. Lewy body disease, people are more likely to have visual hallucinations. They're more likely to have pretty wide fluctuations in how they do. So one day they may be able to function pretty well, another day they won't be able to function as well. And so it can be hard for caregivers, because what a person was very capable of doing one day, they may be totally clueless on how to do that another day. And so sometimes caregivers think they're faking it, or, well, she could do it if she wanted to, she did it yesterday. So it's important to know if it is Lewy body disease, if there are going to be those fluctuations. Plus, Lewy body disease has visual hallucinations associated with it most of the time. Very important to know, because if you treat visual hallucinations with the medicines that are typically used to treat hallucinations, the person could become much worse and sometimes never get back to baseline. So they're particularly sensitive to antipsychotic medications. So it's important to know if they have Lewy body disease. Frontotemporal dementia. If there is something worse than Alzheimer's, in my opinion, think it's frontotemporal dementia. These individuals, their memory is pretty good at first, but it's their behavior and their social functions that go downhill. They do the darndest things and get into predicaments. Yet people don't excuse them for that because their memory is good, so they don't think they're have Alzheimer's or a dementia, when in fact they do have a dementia, but the memory problems come on later, that the behavior and the social skills deteriorate first. Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease is kind of like mad cow disease, as one called Creutzfeldt-Jakob. So it's a prion disorder. Huntington's is a chromosomal defect, genetic disease. If you have that chromosome, you're going to get Huntington's at some point if you live long enough. Traumatic dementia would be people with lots of head trauma or after a close head injury. Toxic dementias could be from alcohol, drugs. And now with people that are getting older that were in that drug culture, some of them when they were younger, we might see more of those types of individuals with dementia secondary to drug abuse when they were younger, if they're still abusing. And then normal pressure hydrocephalus can have dementia. It is part of that. It's important to know if they have that condition, because a lot of times The symptoms can be improved medically by surgery. There's a triad of symptoms with normal pressure hydrocephalus. It's memory problems, urinary incontinence, and gait instability, or kind of abnormal gait. And if, so if those three things present kind of early, important to look for that for treatment. Some people with Parkinson's disease will have dementia associated, others will not. So it, it just kind of depends. Then there's others. AIDS can have dementia associated with inflammatory disorders and autoimmune disorders. So there's lots of different conditions. But today we're basically going to focus on Alzheimer's because it's the predominant dementia that we see. And as Tasha said, it affects 5.8 million in the U.S., sixth leading cause of death in people over the age of 65. Important for those of you that work in the community, 70 to 80% of community dwelling, they're out there, they're among us. And we need to provide the supports they need to function as highly as they can. It's primarily a disease of older people, but 200,000 people, it's estimated, under the age of 65 have Alzheimer's disease. And someone very, very close to me has just been diagnosed under the age of 65, and it's devastating. It's devastating whatever age, but when you're young and have to try to raise a family, it's been really difficult. This statistic, I think, is so troubling. One in three older Americans dies with Alzheimer's or another dementia. It just shows us how important it is to learn more about this, this condition of dementia. And then, particularly important for elder abuse, to know the numbers, estimated that 16 million unpaid caregivers are providing care for older adults. And look at the number of hours. That's, I mean, it's amazing the amount of care that is given to older individuals. And the majority of caregivers do an excellent job, but there is potential for abuse because of all the behavioral changes. And so let's look at the brain changes of Alzheimer's disease. There's three things, two of them are, cause the third, basically. There's amyloid plaques, neurofibrillary tangles, and because of those two things, you get the brain to atrophy. So this would be a very, very simplified schematic of the normal brain with the neurons in the brain kind of communicating with each other. There are estimated to be between 86 billion and 100 billion nerve cells in the typical human brain. So you can see that if this looks so simple, but it's not. Each one of those nerve cells can have up to 10,000 synapses. So very complicated system. And this is next picture here. The inset shows where the synapse is, and that's where this abnormal protein, the beta amyloid, collects there. So it will not allow nerve transmission from one cell to the next. Here is another, can you see my arrow? This is the beta amyloid collecting. This would be a normal nerve cell down here. You can see where the normal nerve cell is nice and firm, it's kind of straight. Look at this one, it's twisting upon itself. This is because tau, another protein, is accumulating and causing the microtubules to collapse. And so you get neurofibrillary tangles inside. So you're having problems outside and inside the nerve cells. Because of that, you get brain atrophy. And the brain on the left would be a normal brain. Look at the one on the right, you can see how it just would be totally unable to function like it should. This is a schematic of a normal brain, one with Alzheimer's, and then superimposed here, you can see how much atrophy there is. And then this would be a cross section, and you can look at what the healthy brain should be like And then this is where I really want you to look right now at the hippocampus. It's almost absent over here, where here there's lots of tissue. And we'll talk about hippocampus a little bit further. This would be a person with severe Alzheimer's, a brain imaging study. Here's their normal brain. You can see the loss in brain volume. Here's a PET scan, which is positron emission tomography scan. The normal on the left, what this type of PET scan does is shows metabolic activity. So this is showing you that all these parts of the brain, they're lit up bright. Whoops, that's the wrong way. That are very bright, those are functioning. Here's the Alzheimer's brain. Look how cool it is, where metabolic activity isn't occurring. Those brain cells can't work. So where does this happen? Where do those tangles and plaques happen? Well, in Alzheimer's disease, it affects the cortical part of the brain, or the outer part of the brain, the higher thinking levels of the brain first. And so that's why we're gonna have those types of symptoms, because that's where the tangles and plaques are going. It also affects this structure here. Hippocampus. Remember how it was almost absent on that schematic? Is where it sits. Now, when we look at this, would be a diagram showing mild, moderate, and more advanced Alzheimer's disease. Those tangles and plaques start here in the hippocampus. That's why with Alzheimer's disease, you're going to see memory problems as probably the presenting symptom. As the disease progresses, then those tangles and plaques start spreading throughout the brain toward the end of life for a person with Alzheimer's. The entire brain is pretty much consumed with tangles and plaques, not allowing the brain to function. So let's move on talking about the brain functions affected. Memory, judgment, decision making, abstract thinking, ability to control your inhibitions or impulse control, organization skills, a person's motivation and attention. We're going to talk about all these individually and talk more. But I want to look at the top
the memory, and then go five more
points here. All of those, the judgment, decision making, abstract thinking, inhibition control, organizational skills, and motivation and attention, all are frontal lobe functions. So you need an intact frontal lobe in order to have those skills. If you have a frontal temporal dementia, those are the skills that are going to be affected. And it creates a lot of problems for caregivers when a person has poor judgment. They can't think abstractly. Their impulse control is out the window. They can't organize themselves, and their motivation, attention is off. So then these are other brain functions that are affected by Alzheimer's. The person's personality, their ability to perceive things, emotional control, language, motor function, and visual spatial skills. So let's first of all look at memory. And again, it's that hippocampus where the tangles and plaques start, and then they spread throughout the brain. But the way I tell when I would talk to families is say, it's like the person can't get deposits into their memory. They can make withdrawals on memories that are there. So that long-term memory is pretty well preserved early on. But as the disease progresses, they lose that too. Eventually, they probably will not even be able to recognize the image of man. But early on, it's just getting new information into storage. It's kind of like a faulty save function on your computer. So sometimes things get in, but a lot of times they don't. The other thing that's important to focus on with poor short-term memory is you have a floating reference point for time. If you don't have short-term memory to anchor you, you can't tell time. 5 minutes may seem like 5 hours. 5 hours may seem like 5 minutes. And so people with Alzheimer's may get very impatient with someone when it's been a reasonable amount of time, but they think the person's taking too long. Or a person with Alzheimer's may be kind of content just to kind of sit and do nothing for extended periods of time because they don't realize how much time has passed. They don't have that anchor for them because of their short-term memory. So what we're going to see would be difficulty learning new information. They forget things. They misplace items. Spend a lot of time looking for things. Trouble following directions because they can't remember the directions, particularly if they're multi-step directions. They don't remember the date, time, maybe the season. Forget recent conversations. Well, then they might accuse the caregiver. You never told me that. When they actually did, but they just don't recall it. So moving on then to talk about judgment decision making. There's a loss of sense of risk and danger. People don't have a good judgment anymore. And the example I oftentimes give here, I couldn't believe this gentleman did this, but he was one of our patients. He had Alzheimer's disease and he was mowing the grass. He didn't know if there was gas in the gas can. So he lit a match to see if there was gas. Of course, it exploded. He was not severely injured, but it did start his garage on fire. They lose that sense of, if I do this, this will happen. I can't anticipate that. Financial vulnerability is huge here. People can take advantage of them big time. They may forget to pay bills, may forget to pay the taxes. This was years and years ago when we used to have, those of you that are younger, which probably are most of you, don't recall when paper boys used to deliver the newspaper and then they would come around collecting. Well, I asked the family one day, I said, well, when did you first notice that your mom had a winter box? I said, well, we didn't really notice it was the paper boy. And I said, the paper boy? And she said, yeah. Mom kept saying, I need more money for the paper board. He started collecting every day. But she figured out she forgot what she paid him. Oh, he's probably in jail these days. I don't know. they're just so vulnerable. You see the financial vulnerability.
Yeah, because people are forgetting to pay the bills or they make double or triple payments for utilities and they have a credit on their account. They don't have money for prescriptions because it didn't clear because they thought they had more money and they really didn't. That's when our elder abuse prevention program really gets involved.
Well, and that's one of the first things that really families will really pay attention to because I mean, they figure it's going on okay and then something like that comes low. They have difficulty prioritizing activities and they can't tell what's important. Something insignificant to the rest of us might seem extremely important to them and they won't pay attention to something that we think is very important. Unable to anticipate the consequences of action, we kind of talked about that. This would not be the time for them to joke with the TSA agent. That they have a bomb in their suitcase or something. But sometimes we've had people do that. They may trust strangers. Sometimes they think they know everybody. Everybody's their friend, or everybody's not their friend sometimes. But we've had a lot of times our patients would trust strangers before they would trust their family, which is puts them at a very, very vulnerable spot. And then poor interpretation of social cues. Most of us, if we have an intact frontal lobe, we know, ooh, that person's getting annoyed with us. I better back off. Kids are really good at this. They'll push you, push you, push you, but then they go, oh, mom's getting at the end of her rope. I better back off. But people with frontal lobe impairment, they don't interpret those social cues. So then they push you and don't know when to back off. And it really create a very volatile situation. So then moving on to abstract thinking. If you don't have a functioning frontal lobe, we think very literally of the words have very literal meaning. The example here that I use, because it just startled me when this lady said it to me. She was a 93-year-old lady and we were doing a workup on her for the first time. And I asked her, have you ever smoked? Because that was important for us to know for safety reasons. And she looked at me like I was nuts. And she said, honey, I've never gotten that hot. I didn't get it at first. She wasn't joking. That was how literal she was. People with frontal lobe impairment get themselves in trouble because if they see a piece of junk mail coming saying, you have just won, they think they've won. Or if it says urgent, they think it's urgent when it's just a piece of junk mail. So that concrete thinking and the haze ability to think about things, higher level things, takes a lot more time for them to process information. Again, we talked about funding relationships already, but we had somebody that wrote a check that was supposed to be for $10, but he wrote it for $1,000 for getting the decimal point. And then when he saw, when he wrote $1,000 in the one part where you wrote the number, then he wrote $1,000. Again, just very confused about calculations. And they may have a change in sense of humor because so much of humor is play on words, and they may not get jokes anymore. So you have to be careful if you're going to joke with them, but make sure that they. And sometimes they do just fine with it, but sometimes they may misunderstand jokes. Inhibition control. This part of my brain is extremely important to filter out things and to keep me from doing socially inappropriate things. So if I see it and I have no frontal lobe there to help me, I'm going to sit, you know, I'm going to say comment on it, or I'm going to act on it. So very, very impulsive. If I may steal, because, oh, that's nice and shiny, I want that, when I don't mean to steal at all, but it's just a very simplified, oh, I like that, I'm just going to put it in my pocket. They can get frustrated very easily. A lot of times they'll curse and swear and become aggressive because they just get so frustrated. They may make hurtful or insensitive comments, not because they mean it, but if you just think if everything came into your head, kind of came out your mouth, it wouldn't be good. So very, very difficult for caregivers to handle. And then there's a possibility for sexual disposition also. And then I need this part of my brain so I know how to plan, organize, and sequence. I may be very willing to cooperate, but I don't know how to start things. So people may stay in their clothes rather than change into their night clothes because they don't remember how to start the task of getting ready for bed and taking their clothes off and putting their pajamas on. They may be if they're very apathetic or disinterested because they don't know how to get going. And if the caregiver starts them and nudges them along, they can do just fine. But if left to their own, they may not get going on things and trouble following directions because they need to be called how to follow those directions. They forgot what the directions were. And then motivation and attention is a frontal lobe function. You would have trouble with initiating. We talked about that already, but also they can get stuck. And you've probably seen this. If you go into a nursing facility and you've ever heard a nurse or a patient yell, nurse, 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 and they say, well, what can we help you with? And then nothing, I'm okay. And then you're not even out of the room, nurse. They get stuck. And it's kind of like they get something in their head and they can't move on. So there's a loss of mental flexibility. On the flip side, they can get so distractible that they can't focus on anything. And so they try to get a task completed. They start it and then something catches their eye over here, they go do that. And then something catches their eye over here, they go do that. So difficulty maintaining effortful activities, distractibility, or latching on. It just can run all the gamut of all of those. So when I think of frontal lobe dysfunction or executive dysfunction, there's going to be problems with starting, stopping, switching, socialization, planning, and judgment, which it's very obvious that the problems you could get yourself into with those. So the way I think of it is, imagine driving a car with no steering and no brakes, but you're going full throttle. And so these individuals can create so many difficulties for their parents because a lot of times they have no insight. So moving on, we're going from the frontal lobe now to other parts of the brain. Personality and perception. People with Alzheimer's disease can have paranoia. They can become suspicious, have abnormal or unusual beliefs. Delusions. The most common delusions for people with Alzheimer's disease are delusions of theft, because if you misplaced it, you can't find it. Somebody took it. So delusions of theft, delusions of infidelity, where they're accusing their spouse of having affairs, which the spouse is like, oh my gosh, I'm so tired, I couldn't have an affair if I wanted to. But that's pretty common. And then delusions of persecution. Everybody nobody likes me. Everybody's picking on me. Nobody values me anymore. Those sorts of things. Hallucinations are more common in Lewy body dementia than they are in Alzheimer's disease, but they can occur. If you have Lewy body dementia hallucinations, they're usually very vivid visual hallucinations, oftentimes of children and grotesque things, sometimes just horrible and very disturbing to the individual. The person may be fearful that their brain isn't working. Can you imagine how confused they would feel? So they might start shadowing the caregiver. And this is particularly annoying for female caregivers if they've been in the home and their husband retires, it's Alzheimer's disease, it starts shadowing them, follows them around all day. They get very, very frustrated with that. And then there's a lack of empathy or ability to see another person's point of view. They become very self-centered, not because they want to, but because their ability to be considerate of others and to have that social awareness goes kind of down the tubes. Then there's emotional discontrol. It can go everywhere from depression, anxiety, denial. There's nothing wrong with me. It's you, and you keep bugging me. And that's really hard, particularly if there's financial abuse going on and they still want to manage their own finances. Very labile emotions sometimes. A lot of times with vascular dementia, after a person's had a stroke, they'll have these real labile emotions. And they can get angry very quickly, withdraw. And then language changes. Early on, language is pretty good for people with Alzheimer's disease. Then they have some word-finding difficulties. Then they might have trouble with nouns. And I think that your person that's going to talk about communication techniques will mention this, but they have difficulty using nouns and naming things. So if they might say, give me that thing over there, you know, that thing that has milk in it. You mean your glass? Yeah. And so if you ask them to name things, they may have difficulty. Loses train of thought in mid-sentence, very difficult to filter out distractions during conversations if other things are going on. And it takes quite a bit longer to process information because language is not as automatic as it used to be. So one paper I read, and I've always kind of kept this in mind, said it takes about 15 seconds longer for a person with moderate Alzheimer's disease to understand and process than it does when we're not there. So you really need to slow down.
That's helpful because I think a lot of our caregivers and even us as professionals going into a situation where you don't realize dementia is present is trying to rephrase it and then they still don't get it. So 15 seconds doesn't seem like a lot until you give them three different tasks of read this, sign that, and date it. That's a lot of information. So that's important. Thank you.
Another thing to keep in mind is they may hear you, but not comprehend the meaning. We had a patient I was working with once, and he would say, I can't hear you. So I would get a little louder, a little lower, a little slower. And he said, I can't hear you. I said, okay. Well, I'm finding his voice. Barb, there's nothing wrong with his hearing. What he was meaning is, I don't understand you. And I wasn't getting it. You know, our patients will teach us if we will let them. And I was really embarrassed, but he wasn't comprehending. He wasn't understanding what I was trying to convey to him. So motor functioning also can be impaired. It's loss of motor memory. And I'm just going to ask Tasha, because she has the earbuds in. When you put shoes on, like your athletic shoes, do you think about that?
I try not tying them. I leave them tied so I can slip them right on. but no, I mean, I do think about it because that's part of the process.
Yeah. Have you ever gotten home and wondered how I get here?
All the time.
We do that automatically. Mm-hmm. All that is just, we do so much of our life automatically. Resting. You don't think about, oh, I get this on and this on. No, you would. Well, we've all used that. So we need a lot more time to pass. We need, as the progressions, we need assistance with daily activities because they don't have that motor memory. Mm-hmm. They don't rush well. A lot of times we try to rush them.
Oh, for sure.
I always tell people, it's slow, it's quicker. Because if you try to rush them, everybody's going to get frustrated, and the caregiver may even get it. So take it slow. Then visual spatial skills, another important function that is lost with Alzheimer's disease. And this is where you are in relationship to your environment. They may fall because they don't know where one step starts and one stops. They may wonder because they just don't try to figure out their environment. Usually with Alzheimer's disease, people will have difficulty in unfamiliar settings first, then maybe have trouble finding their way in their own neighborhood, eventually will have trouble finding their way in their own home and not be able to go from room to room. The other thing with visual spatial skills for us to be very aware of is personal space, and we're all really aware of that with COVID right now. This is different, but people with Alzheimer's disease can't judge how close somebody is to them. So I'll give you an example. I walked up to a gentleman in our waiting room one day, and I bent down, and this was a guy I knew really well. He was just so sweet, and he jumped back and startled me. I jumped back too, but I said, oh, I'm sorry. And he said, I thought you were going to kiss me. I thought, whoa, I had no intention. But in his mind, the way he was perceiving things, I approached too quickly, and I was way too close. I was comfortable in my personal space, my zone, but I was invading his. I'm lucky he didn't strike out. And that can happen with people with Alzheimer's disease. If people approach too fast, or they think that somebody's in their face, they may strike out. Geographic disorientation, talked about. And then trouble understanding visual images or recognizing things. Like I said early on, eventually they won't be able to recognize their own image computer, probably. But have you ever gone to the refrigerator? I'll ask you again. and opened it up looking for the ketchup, and it's right in front of you, but it takes you a while to see it.
I've touched it a few, it over. I'm yelling at my kids, and why they find it, but it's right there.
Yeah. It's that kind of moment where you're looking for something, and it comes back that way. It's momentary. The people with Alzheimer's disease may be at the table and say, where's my fork? Right in front of them, and they don't. So all those things can really make a very confusing world for us at all times. So let's just look at these things in mild, moderate, or advanced dementia. So in mild dementia, the person could have short-term memory, they're going to be repetitive and ask questions over and over again. And I'll just say, when they've done studies with caregivers, what is the most difficult for you? I was shocked. In one study, repetitive questions was at the top. And down further was when they strike out at the person, the caregiver. But repetitive questions just drives people nuts after a while. Misplacing items. They put things in funny places. They might put the car keys in the refrigerator or stuff. Or the other thing, to hide things because they're afraid somebody's going to take them. And then they don't remember where they hit them. Depression and social withdrawal. Sometimes people, they withdraw because they know they have trouble with conversations. They know they have trouble with other keeping track of things. So they just pull back. It's kind of a protective measure. That socialization is very important. We just have to modify how we socialize. Trouble handling on finances, that decision making. Mild language changes, but pretty well able to converse in this stage. And difficulty managing household affairs. They buy multiple things when they go shopping of things they already have at home, but important items they don't need them. And they may start having some confusion when driving. Most people with mild Alzheimer's disease are still better. And that's a big, big hairy topic of when should a person stop driving. So with mild Alzheimer's or mild dementia, the person looks normal. So we kind of expect them to act and behave and function as they always have. And if I'm working, particularly if I'm talking with nursing assistants in a nursing home, I'll say, would you ever say to this person, oh, come on, stand on your own 2 feet? Of course not. We never would. The person has had cellular loss. She doesn't have a leg. Well, people with Alzheimer's disease have cell loss too, only it's in the brain and you can't see it. So by expecting them to behave and act in ways that they were able to before, it's just as ludicrous as asking a person with amputation to stand there on their own 2 feet. In fact, when I was doing studies, a lot of times I was responsible for doing some of the neuropsychological assessments and the testing. I was struck at how hard people tried with Alzheimer's disease. They gave it their all. They really did. Moderate dementia, everything just is getting worse. They're going to have not only difficulty with short-term memory, but long-term memory starts to go. They forget important parts of their own personal history. May not remember where they were born or where they went to school, or they may not remember nieces and nephews. Less able to express themselves and make their needs known, so that you have to kind of anticipate what they might need. They may have disorientation not only to time, but time and place. They may wonder, they need assistance with personal care here. They may not think they need assistance with personal care. They get kind of feisty sometimes, and delusions and hallucinations can occur. And then a lot of times, up at night, a lot of sleep changes, and very, very difficult. And then advanced dementia, I think we're all pretty familiar with the own fragments of memory. They need total care. Language is no longer understood, or they can form language. They're difficult to engage in activities of any sort, but you still need to try. Nutrition problems. They're no longer mobile, and they're very vulnerable to infections. So challenges facing caregivers. We're just taking those symptoms and kind of looking at them again. These sorts of things. I mean, when you look at all of these, you wonder how a caregiver ever does it with all they're faced with. The person's personality changes. If you need something and you say, Bob, what did you do with that bill we got? I don't know, I never had it. Well, yeah, I saw you have it in your hand. So I don't know, I don't. And you're looking for things all the time. Or if they tell you, oh yeah, I paid the water bill, and you didn't. So they just shouldn't have responsibility for their finances, but a lot of people don't want to give that up. Inattention to household tasks. So if you take a spousal pair and the woman has always been on this household task and she's no longer able to do those, the husband may get very frustrated with her, thinking that she should be able to do those yet. They're dealing, caregivers are dealing with a person that has lack of insight into their deficits. I can handle my own clients. I can still drive. I drive better than anybody else. I've never had a what is amazing to me is the people who are still taking their own medications when they're in dementia.
She says she is. The person is always changing, and they have the idea that everything is fine. But the caregivers are in a completely different story. So trying to articulate when the person with dementia can become very combative because you're talking bad about them. And so that's a lot of our meetings with families. It's very troubling to encourage a caregiver understand where the person with dementia is, and just trying to find that happy medium.
Well, it can be that's a perfect setup for the caregiver. They may say okay and just go and neglect the person. Other challenges, embarrassing behavior. People with Alzheimer's, because of that inhibition control, they may do embarrassing things. One gentleman told me, I can't keep my wife out to eat anymore. And I said, why? He said, we went out to eat to the salad bar. And she went over and tasted with the serving spoon. And the fish she said was, I didn't know if I'd like it. I don't want to take it if I don't like it. Well, of course, that's not appropriate. But it was very, very embarrassing. I just said, when you go to a restaurant, don't go to the salad bar. Just use plain food, and you'll be okay for a while yet. So, sometimes caregivers just need a little listening to and a little, get some alternative ideas. The insensitive comments can be very hard, particularly if they're very critical of their grandkids or something. Why are you here with all those tattoos? You look awful. Well, grandkids don't, nobody likes to do that, but it can cause alienation if the person doesn't. Caregivers, I don't know how they do it sometimes, the person's up all night. Caregivers will say, I can handle the daytime if I can sleep at night. But when they're up at night, it's very, very difficult to have patients the whole day. Another thing that really bothers caregivers is when the person with dementia is very apathetic. They'll just say they won't offer anything they want to do, but they don't have the organizational skills to come up with something to do. If you give them choices, then they can choose. But apathy and lack of initiative is really bad. We had a gentleman with frontal lobe dementia. His apathy was so bad that but his memory was pretty good. He would talk with us about the baseball game the night before and who hit what. But when you asked him his wife said, he poops his pants. And so he said, Mr. So-and-so, your wife said that having difficulty with your soil number. He said, she can clean it up. He was so apathetic, he couldn't make it up and use the restroom. His wife had had stroke. She was in poor health, but he didn't make the connection that I'm doing something that's harmful for my life. He just had that severe apathy and not seeing things from another person's point of view. Day-to-day variabilities in function, again, with Lewy body disease, they did it one day, but they can't do it another. So sometimes caregivers, if they don't recognize that that's part of it, they'll say, well, he's just being stubborn. He could do it if he wanted. He could do it yesterday. Why can't he do it today? That's part of the disease. Even the individual's loss of caregivers, the person's there in front of them, but they're different. They're not the same. And that can go on. So that's really difficult for the person. When a person refuses care, I already took a bath. I'm not dirty. I just put these clothes on today, or maybe they've worn them for 5 days. Very difficult for caregivers, and it's kind of a setup for neglect. Okay, just go ahead. Verbal or physical outbursts, we talked about the rest of this. The last one, no longer recognizing the caregiver, that's like a dagger to the heart. I'll tell you, one of my friends, her husband last year, she said, I don't know that he recognizes me all the time. He stayed at home. And she said one day, she said, let's go take a walk. And he goes, great. Yeah, let's go. And she said, well, I'm going to get my shoes on. So she's in the bedroom putting her shoes on and performance. And she answers it, it's her husband. She said, hey, we're going to take a walk. Do you want to join us? And I said, oh, well, that's really sweet. But she said, but I don't think we recognize this anymore. And it was really, really tough for her. So all these behaviors and all those challenges make an environment that is kind of right for abuse and neglect. This top one, though, to me, you're challenged, you're stressed out, and then you're worried that you're going to become violent with the person with dementia, the PWD is person with dementia. Carrying that around would be very difficult. That jumps up to 57% if the person with dementia acted toward them was violent toward them. I mean, that's pretty high. And then it's really hard to get the statistics because usually it's caregiver self-report. And but there were in Canada and England have done quite a few studies, and Australia has too. I found three international studies, and the range was between 34% and 62% admitted to abuse. A U.S. study said about half, one U.S. study. So psychological abuse was the most common. That would include emotional and verbal. Physical abuse ranged from about 3.5% to 23%. And then 20% reported neglect from the person. Who knows what sexual abuse, financial exploitation, and many people with dementia experience maybe financial and physical abuse, and financial and emotional. So, and then mutual abuse, that in there. So 33% of caregivers report the person with dementia directed abuse towards them. And caregivers who have been abused are more likely to be abusive back. But pretty much across the board, the more advancing a person is into their disease with more functional impairment, the more likely that they are to abuse the caregiver. And if you think about it, they don't have language to help them, so they can't talk it out. Maybe before, if they would get real upset with their caregiver, they would go outside. Well, maybe they can't go outside anymore because they are wandering. So it's abuse can go either way. And factors increasing the risk of abuse would be, as we mentioned, the process we talked about. If the person with dementia and the caregiver had a poor relationship before, much more likely to have difficulties with abuse or neglect. And aggressive or violence by the person with dementia, that certainly increases the risk of abuse. Mental health issues such as depression in caregivers really raises the risk for abuse. Substance abuse, alcohol abuse, coping skills of caregiving with a caregiver. Or if the caregiver felt socially isolated. So often when a person becomes demented, their friends start fading away and don't come around as much. So if the caregiver's feeling really socially isolated, or they feel trapped, I'm the only one that can do this, they're more likely to become abusive. And if they're not utilizing support services. And when I was working, I can't tell you the number, we would make referrals, and the person with the caregiver would say, well, it's not that bad yet. Well, how bad does it have to be? You just get some help in there. And then passive abuse, where the person that's giving care just lacks skills or knowledge to give the good care. So another thing to consider is self-neglect. Often the caregiver dies first. They're reluctant to use formal services. They may feel over-responsible. I promised, my wedding vows said, or I promised her I'd never put her in a nursing home. And so they'd almost rather neglect the person's needs than put in the nursing home. A lot of times the caregiver's in poor health too. And financial stress, worried about dwindling all their finances down so that the caregiver doesn't have enough to live on to. And there's tons of research out there on caregivers, and they tend to neglect their own health. If they exercise before assuming the caregiver role, they may not exercise, they may not eat as well, they may not go out and be around friends, so they put off routine health care. It's a situation that can be very, very tense. So abuse and neglect can originate from either the caregiver or a person with dementia. Everybody deserves to be safe. So the goals of care for people with dementia, this is what I always say, but this is the goals of care for the caregiver too. We all need to feel safe. We all need to have a sense of control, feel comfortable, free of pain, feel comfortable. Optimum stimulation, which is really hard because for a person with dementia, that varies from day to day, sometimes moment to moment. We all need some pleasure in our lives, and we all need to feel valued as a person. Even people with advanced dementia have a need to feel valued as a person. So going back to our objective, we can talk about what the term dementia means, decline in memory and cognitive skills that are severe enough to impair the person's day-to-day functioning. We talked about all those different brain functions and how it interplays for symptoms and how those affect the person's ability to cooperate with care or the patient's the person's ability to give care. So I want to thank you all very much
for giving me this opportunity. And
It doesn't look like we have any right now. It looks like the comments we did have was the feedback when both of us are talking. But I think that, you know, you went really in depth with, you know, the different types of dementia, but also, you know, a lot of the things that we see that we have heard from caregivers, from family members, and what we've even seen ourselves. When we have people who may not have the actual diagnosis of dementia or a form of dementia, you know, they don't see what's happening. They don't see their challenges, and they neglect or they refuse services. And until we have that piece of paper from the doctor stating they're unable to make those decisions, you know, it's that fine line of self-determination, but also, you know, is there a cognitive impairment that's causing them not to see the full consequences?
It's important for the person to get a diagnosis, get to see a doctor, because some of these things that we talked about, these symptoms, could be due to, say, medications a person on, could be due to depression, it could be to some metabolic disturbances. So you want to make sure that anything that can be treated and tuned up is tuned up before you just assume that it's Alzheimer's disease or some other problem. So I think very, very important to get people get to the doctor and make sure that the memory problems have been adequately assessed. Other comments? No?
I think you did a very thorough job on explaining everything and, you know, providing that some other helpful information for us to not only support our caregivers, but, you know, things for us providers to slow down. And, you know, for me, just because somebody doesn't have the dementia diagnosis doesn't mean that. No, that's okay. I'll take it back. Doesn't mean that they're not having issues with cognitive inability or any impairment. So that was helpful for me.
Well, I thank everybody.
Oh, I just want to thank everybody very much who got on today, and I just feel very, very strongly that this is an area that we all need more education on. And over the years, my patients taught me a lot, and caregivers taught me a lot. And it's very rewarding to work with people, but it's also frustrating. I just, when you know kind of what the trajectory is for people, it's very difficult. And so they need all the support they can get. Thank you.
I have to mute you. Can you mute yourself? Can you see that? You can.
Okay.
So I just want to talk a little bit about connections as a whole here at, there we go, now you're muted. So Connections Area Agency on Aging, it is, you know, your local area agency on aging. We serve the 20 Southwest counties that you can see here. We have three office locations, Council Bluffs, Sioux City, and Creston, to be able to do this. We have a few different categories of services. We have our healthy living, which most people know is about our home delivered meals, or meals on wheels is another word. We also will do the senior centers, congregate meals, and then we also have our community engagement. These are going to be the ones that you see, you know, at our fairs. These are the ones that do like our marketing. We also have an RSVP program, so those that are retired but still like to stay busy, we do work with them to volunteer and share their talents. We partner with IO Vocational Rehab and be able to offer an older employee program to be able to help them with any of the challenges they may have. And then we also, in our Sioux City and our Council Bluffs office, is that we offer a program. We partner with SHIP, or Senior Health Insurance. education program. So anybody that is new to Medicare or is currently on Medicare but has some questions, we have amazing volunteers that come in and will educate individuals and help them pick the right plan. They are not paid. They don't, you know, suggest one program or another. They give you all the information that you're needing. So that's a great opportunity, a great program for a lot of individuals. And then we have our consumer services program. This is going to be, you know, when you call our 800 number, our information and intake staff. We also have options counselors, service navigators who are able to work with individuals and families, meet where they are at their home, at the local cafe, eventually back in our office to look at, you know, what is the current needs, what are some options, what are some resources to connect them to help them maintain their independence. Then we also have a case management program. It's a little bit more in depth with longer term options counseling. And then we'll kind of get into a little bit more of the elder abuse prevention program, as well as our caregiver program. So briefly on elder abuse, it is when somebody harms or neglects a person who is 60 years or older. Each state has their own definition, but Iowa is 60 years and older. It can happen to anybody. Nobody is immune to this. Nobody is safe from this. It can come from a caregiver, a family member, a neighbor, or even a complete stranger. This is kind of like when the scammers come in. That's a category they fall in. It can take place at a person's home, at a relative's home. So if they go and visit their children, at assisted living, or even in a nursing facility. There's different forms of abuse: physical, emotional, sexual, financial neglect, which would be confinement or abandonment would fall into that, as well as self-neglect. So neglecting any of their basic needs, hygiene, shelter, food, prescriptions, things like that. So a little bit about our elder abuse prevention program. Again, in order to be eligible, one would have to be 60 years or older, and at risk for a form of abuse or has been abused, or even, you know, themselves, elders whose needs are not being met by themselves. Caregivers who are experiencing concern, they can fall in a couple different of our programs because we want to make sure that they are taken care of to prevent any future abuse that may or may not occur. People with multiple health or social needs, it's usually not just one abuse that's happening. Usually there's multiple layers of needs there. Our services are voluntary. We do get some calls that people are like, somebody needs to go out and see my mom. You know, she needs help. We can call and talk to mom and say, hey, this is who we are. But until we have something from the court to the doctor, they have the right to decline our services. And oftentimes people do for a few different reasons. We partner a lot with our Adult Protective Services, or APS, within our state. So usually if somebody calls them and they don't meet their definition of eligible, they will refer to us, which is a great step in the right direction. Over the last few years, we've really worked on that relationship. And if somebody is working with APS, we partner with them as well. So we can do wraparound services and be able to support each other in that. If somebody is open to our program, that they do, we will do a full assessment with them, identify what their needs are, who are the key players on their team, and how do we protect them and how do we keep them safe. And we do follow up to make sure that their risk was eliminated. For our caregivers, caregivers, a lot of times they're not neglecting or abusing on purpose. It is that passive neglect is what we see often. The caregivers are just burnt out for a number of reasons, especially when we are talking about any form of dementia, is the person changes moment by moment. And if it is a spouse or if it's a parent, that role that they used to fulfill, they're not able to do so anymore. So everybody's changing, and that added stress. Even when the caregiver is still working, that's an added stress. If we have adult children who may or not be present, they may not fully understand what's going on, what the needs are, or even how to communicate effectively with the person with dementia. So through our caregiver program, we offer information and assistance, counseling and education. So the different supports that are available, we have support groups, we have trainings. We just, you know, even our caregiver specialist, she will listen to people just call and just unload on what's going on, just that listening ear, which a lot of caregivers, they don't have. And then we also offer respite services for those that are eligible. We have individuals that can come in with the different agencies to provide that break. So caregivers can go out and have coffee with their girlfriends, or, you know, go fishing with their buddies, or just go to a lake and read a book to get their hair done, whatever other errands they may need. So they know that their loved one is cared for, but they can also get that break as well. So we kind of talked a little bit about more about the caregiver stress. Caregivers, I think it's tough to get them to identify themselves as a caregiver, because oftentimes it's like, well, this is my husband, or this is my mom, this is my aunt, this is just what I do. But to help them understand that they are a caregiver and to take care of themselves is very challenging, to give them the permission to take care of themselves and to take that moment to just have a cup of coffee on the back porch, to have a friend come and sit, you know, maybe with the husband and watch a football game. It's okay to have people come into the house and to help. And it's okay to accept that help. I know a lot of times within our elder abuse program, it is talking more with the caregivers, and it's okay. When it comes to the promises that I promised I would never put them in a facility. Well, you know, situations have changed and their needs have changed, and it's okay. We give a lot of permission, I guess, for lack of better words, for them to do it. So we talked about active and passive neglect, so I won't go into that. But, you know, who to call if people are concerned. That's the big thing, is I know something is not right, but I don't know what to do. So oftentimes people don't do anything. But if the person that you're concerned about is at home, if there's any medical staff that are going in, it's talking with them, maybe talking with the doctor. Most smaller communities, it's the same doctor that people see. So just calling and talking to the nurse up there. Family or friends, if you maybe see or someone's concerned about a neighbor, it's coming over to check with somebody. Different support groups are available. We are available here at Connections just to call and say, hey, I think something is off. What do I need to do? That's most of my calls that I handle. And then obviously the police, if there is, you know, you are concerned. If somebody's in a facility, it would be talking with the licensing board, the ombudsman office, and we have those numbers. So we always, you know, are helpful for that as well. Here are some numbers specifically for Iowa Adult Protective Services. This is one that when people call us about concerns, this is the number we usually give often, is we want to make sure they're following the right steps. Our office there, 800-432-9209. Great number to have just to call and just say, hey, I have a question. Local police, but if you are concerned, you know, 911 is a universal number. Concern about, you know, legal rights. Is this right? Do I need to get the power of attorney? What is a power of attorney? What do I need to do to be able to help take care of my parents? Iowa Legal Aid is a great resource, a great starting point on what questions to ask, what terms to use, and then, you know, just kind of what that process is. Financial exploitation, if there is a concern, the Iowa Attorney General's number is listed there. They will take reports, they will provide resources as well of what to do and what to look for. A great thing that we had started, because we've seen a gap within our services and we've heard from providers such as yourself, is I wish I knew more information about elder abuse. I wish I knew what resources were available. So with the collective effort from a few different service professionals, we had started the WRAP Coalition. So Western Iowa Region Adult Abuse Prevention. Acronym is always fun because you have to have an acronym for it to be real. But we do have it is regionalized. So we have one up in our Sioux City region, our Council Bluffs area, and then one in Creston as well. These actually started and then COVID decided to make an entrance. So things have shifted a little bit of how this looks, but the whole idea is to provide a network of providers to, you know, an area for them to ask questions, to provide resources, and for us to be able to know who are the players in the community and what's needed to be able to do that. So we do have a listserv that is through Google Groups. So if you are interested in that and not already on that, go ahead and email me and we can add you to that. Once we kind of get back into the swing of things, we are looking at doing some quarterly meetings. We may look at doing some virtual ones just so we can get back into that as well. So we would love to have you if you're not already part of it. And you know what to do if you, again, it's know the signs, talk it out, keep the conversation going. This isn't just something that happens in June. It happens all year long, unfortunately. But knowing that we need to work together as a community, as service providers, we can't do it alone. We need each other and to be able to do that. And then I would throw in, again, the WRAP coalition is to join us. We're fun when we do meet in person that I do have cookies. So again, I do appreciate all of you that have joined us today, especially with the short notice. So thank you again for making this priority. And again, sorry for the technical difficulties, and we are rolling through this one step at a time. So if you are joining us tomorrow, awesome. Tomorrow at 2 is going to be talking with Acacia with Alzheimer's Association about effective communication. As Barb had mentioned, you know, that's a big concern that caregivers have is how do we communicate? Like, what are we working with and how do we better serve the person with dementia? And then I will send out the certificates of participation as well as a survey. If there is additional questions, feel free to email me and we can go from there. Try to see I can't see your chat, Mary. Sorry. My computer is not being nice here. But again, I do appreciate it. And then again, Monday, wear purple, and then check out the Bob Carey Pedestrian Bridge if you are in the Council Bluffs, Omaha area. And then again, keep that conversation going. Thank you again.